Good morning and welcome to SNS and this seminar about the OECD's recent work on international tax policy, the so-called base erosion and profit shifting project, BEPS. My name is Rickard Eriksson and I'm a research director here at SNS. The background for today's seminar is that the OECD released the so-called BEPS report last week. And this report will be discussed by the G20 leaders in Antalya in November. This is a subject that has been in the center of a public debate both in Sweden and internationally last few years, but it's also a very technical and complex subject when you get into the details. And we are therefore very happy to have David Bradbury with us today. David is the head of tax policy and the statistics division at the OECD and responsible for contributing to the BEPS project. The BEPS project consists of 15 action points, and David Bradbury is responsible for one of these action points, but today he will discuss the whole BEPS project. After the presentation, we will get comments from two discussants. Our first discussant is Yvonne Bertlin. Yvonne is CFO and Director of Tax at AstraZeneca Sweden. She has over 20 years of experience with working with tax issues. So AstraZeneca is a very research intensive and a very international company. International taxation and international tax policy is very therefore great importance for AstraZeneca. And Yvonne is therefore very well suited to give comments on the BEPS project from a business point of view. And we are very happy to have Yvonne with us today. Our second discussant is Ingela Wilfors. Ingela is director at the Swedish Ministry of Finance. She has worked with international tax policy for over 20 years. And in recent years, she has been coordinating Sweden's BEPS negotiations. And she has also been very active in the negotiations in OECD in Paris. So Ingela is therefore very well suited to give comments on BEPS from a Swedish government point of view. And we are very happy to have Ingela with us today. Last but not least, we have a very qualified audience with us today, and I therefore think and hope that we will get a very good discussion after the presentation, so a lot of questions from the audience. Finally, if you tweet, please use the hashtag SNSKunskap. So, David, please welcome. The floor is yours.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Rickard, and thank you to SNS for the invitation to be here this morning and to be participating on such a distinguished panel. It's a real pleasure to be here. This is my first visit to Stockholm, so it's been a short visit, but I've seen some highlights already, and it's great to be here with you. I have the privilege of being able to present to you some of the highlights of the BEPS package. And as Rickard mentioned, the BEPS package, which was released and presented last week, released in the first instance by the OECD and then presented to the G20 finance ministers at their meeting in Lima. And that has been endorsed, and that package will now go off to the G20 leaders at their meeting in Antalya in November. I thought, to give you a bit of a sense of how I'll conduct the presentation, I'll begin with some of the background around the project, how it came into being. Then I'll look at some of the economic analysis that underpins the reasons why we are doing what we are doing in relation to the BEPS package. And then I will go through the action items and try and give you a snapshot. I should say there are thousands of pages that have been released in the documentation. I have come across the odd person that has told me that they've read them all. I don't believe them. But the truth is that there is a lot of detail in each of these action items, and part of the challenge in a session like this is to give you a snapshot of what's involved without getting too caught up in the detail. And I will try and do that as I work through each of the individual items. And then I will conclude by talking a little bit about where we go from here. The slide that I have up at the moment, which is about pressures building for reform, and it's important, I think, just to recap and to reflect upon how it is that this project all came into being. And I've got a couple of little converging factors there. We have double non-taxation and stateless income. Part of the background here is that in the 1920s, in fact, the whole notion of tax treaties really came into being as a means of trying to deal with an increased complexity that people were facing as cross-border trade was occurring. So we're talking a long time ago, as companies began to invest across borders, there was always this tension because individual countries have sovereign power to tax. And what happens where two countries or more than two countries seek to tax one transaction in the same or conflicting ways? How do you resolve the tension to make sure that investors do not end up being subject to double taxation? So the whole treaty system, in a sense, was built around this notion of facilitating more trade without double taxation, which is one of the original purposes of the OECD's involvement in tax, was to facilitate international trade and to avoid double taxation. But what we have seen in recent years is there have been changes to the global economy, is that those very rules that were put in place to avoid double taxation have often been used to facilitate double non-taxation or less than appropriate taxation, and in some cases, stateless income. Income that's being derived in a jurisdiction or not in any particular jurisdiction where that is being subject to taxation. So we have all of that. And at the same time, we began to see a breakdown in the international consensus. So we see, particularly with the rise of many of the emerging market economies, a desire to try and ensure that individual countries get their fair share of the tax that should be collected on transactions. And it's in the context of that breaking down of that consensus that the BEPS project has come into being, to try and make sure that we can build a new consensus for the future. We also have the added complexity arising from the global financial and economic crisis and the pressure that that put governments under, with most governments then being forced to undertake rapid programs of fiscal consolidation. And obviously that meant that the questions of where governments were spending their money and where they were raising their revenue became even more important. And then we saw a series of parliamentary inquiries across the globe, whether it be in places like the UK, the US, Australia, more broadly, that focused on the activities of some individual multinational enterprise groups and identified that for all of the size and the observed profitability of these groups, often the levels of taxation being paid in individual jurisdictions did not stack up. And that, of course, resonated out there in the broader community against the backdrop of fiscal consolidation, where people were demanding of governments that some action be taken. And that is largely what has led us to the position where there was consensus around the need for global action. Now, with that need for global action has come some bold action, and it's worth just quickly stating what has occurred over the last few years. We see in September 2013, the G20 leaders endorsed the BEPS action plan. Now, there are 15 action items within the action plan, which I'll show you in a moment. That then led to a series of work being carried out over the last 2 years that has culminated in the last week or so with the release of the package, with 13 reports, not 15 reports, because some of those items have been bundled together in a single report. And that has led to new or reinforced international standards and concrete measures to help countries tackle BEPS. And I think it represents an unparalleled effort, the OECD and G20 countries working together on an equal footing with many developing countries. Now, this notion of an equal footing is important. So the OECD, G20 countries coming together on an equal footing. So the OECD, yes, it has its 34 members and two accession countries. But then on top of that, the non-OECD G20 countries came to the table with an equal say and an equal right to contribute to that process. And the reports that have been presented on the basis of an agreed consensus amongst those countries. And then, particularly over the last year, there's been an expansion of the greater inclusion to bring developing countries more and more into those discussions and to have a seat at the table as well. If you want to know what BEPS ultimately is all about, this is the slide to focus in on. It is about trying to achieve a greater alignment between the place where profits are reported for tax purposes and where the actual economic activity or the value creation is occurring that is generating those profits. And it is this fundamental disconnect between these two propositions that has led us to the position where there has been an agreed consensus that reform needs to occur. And that is the driving principle. That's about greater alignment, but it's about restoring confidence in the system. And as I said earlier, it's about building a global consensus. One point worth making here is that often I hear people say to me, well, look, you know, I think this BEPS project is unnecessary. One reason why I believe it was absolutely necessary is that in the absence of any action from countries in a coordinated way, individual countries were always going to be forced to respond to the demands of BEPS on their own. And if they did that in a unilateral way, the consequences for global investment, for taxpayers that operate across more than one jurisdiction, would have been very, very, very damaging. Being able to approach this in a coordinated multilateral way has been one of the central and most important aspects of the BEPS project. Features of the project, it's been fast-paced. Now, a two-year time frame, many people thought that that was overly ambitious, but in order to hold everyone into the process, to stop people from going off and undertaking unilateral measures, we needed to move and we needed to move fast, and we've done that. We have been through an inclusive process, and I mentioned this before in terms of the equal footing status of the non-OECD G20 countries and the embrace of many developing countries as well. And it has been a transparent process. In fact, the findings, the final reports were released last week by a global webcast. You know, this, and that was the eighth webcast, I think, in fact, that we have held. In addition to that, all of the processes have involved discussion papers, discussion drafts, public comments have been provided, and that has informed the final decision-making that has occurred. So what are the 15 action items? This graph here, this slide, basically tries to give you a breakdown of how we see the various action items. So of the 15, we have three pillars: coherence, substance, transparency, and certainty. And in coherence, we have hybrid mismatch arrangements, CFC rules, interest deduction, harmful tax practices. Substance, we have preventing treaty abuse, avoiding PE status, transfer pricing is actions 8, 9 and 10. And then in transparency, measuring and monitoring BEPS, disclosure rules, transfer pricing documentation in action 13 and dispute resolution. And then we have these other two almost horizontal action items, which one is the digital economy, which is quite pervasive through many of the other action items, and also the multilateral instrument, which I will explain when we get to that action item. So what have we delivered? Well, we've delivered a detailed report on measuring BEPS, which is essentially action item 11. We have delivered minimum standards. We have reinforced international standards on tax treaties and transfer pricing. we have provided common approaches and best practices for domestic law measures. And we have delivered those two analytical reports that I referred to in terms of the digital economy and the multilateral instrument. So what do we know about the impact of BEPS? And through the work of Action 11, there have been a number of dimensions to the work that's been undertaken, but this has been focusing in on the economic impact of BEPS. And in undertaking Action 11, we discovered that there are more than 100 empirical studies, all of which find the existence of BEPS. So when you look at the academic literature, the empirical literature, there is no question that BEPS exists. The only question is there are disagreements over the extent to which it might exist. In the Action 11 report, we present new OECD research that finds that global net annual revenue loss to be in the order of 4 to 10% of corporate income tax revenues, which is between $100 billion and $240 billion US dollars a year on 2014 levels. Now, I should say that one of the difficulties in this area is the lack of good quality data, and your ability to come up with a credible estimate is always impacted by data. But this is using a methodology that is largely based on you know, the best available methodologies used in the empirical work and the best available data, and that is the estimate that we have come up with. The economic work also has identified that BEPS creates many economic distortions, and to go through some of them quickly, we found that the effective tax rates of large MNEs are between 4 and 8.5 percentage points lower than similar domestic-only entities. We found that BEPS favours intangible investments, it favours companies locating their debt in high-tax countries, and also distorts the location of FDI and creates negative tax spillovers across countries. We also found that anti-avoidance measures are effective when introduced in a unilateral way, but we also have concluded that we believe that they will be even more effective if introduced in a coordinated multilateral way. Quickly looking at the scale of BEPS, what I give you in this chart is the low range and the high range, the low bound and the upper bound of the tax that we believe is likely to be foregone as a result of BEPS activities in a single year. And the other columns are the annual GDP. Not the tax revenue, but the annual GDP, the gross domestic product, the size of those economies' output in a given year. And you see that, you know, it's a little bit, the upper bound is a little bit less than half the total GDP of Sweden. So, this is, the stakes are high. We're talking about significant amounts of money. And for some countries, it's even more than their total annual GDP. If we look at some of the indicators that we produce through this work, this one here shows you concentrations of foreign direct investment. Now, FDI by nature are investments between related parties. And what we have done here is we've taken those 14 countries where there is the highest concentration of FDI, all above 50% of GDP, and we have then measured over a period of years changes between what's happening with FDI in that group of countries compared to all the other countries in the sample. And what we see is that it started back in 2005, where that group of countries, their gross FDI to GDP ratio was 38 times the size of the rest of the countries. And then you track through to 2012, and that has actually grown to 99 times the concentration found in those other countries. Now, different concentrations of FDI can be explained by different things, but you know they are fairly compelling numbers and indicate that something unusual is going on. I mentioned earlier the differential in tax rates between large M&E and comparable domestic only. 4 to 8 percentage points is the tax rate differential. This graph here, without examining it in great detail, what it shows is that even though over the last 10, 20 years we've seen reductions in corporate tax rates, what hasn't reduced but what has increased over time is actually the differentials between tax rates across countries. And this is one of the fundamental factors driving BEPS activities, is the changes, the differences, the variations in rates between countries. And you see there that that's been increasing, especially in relation to patent income, where the difference in tax rates has increased by an even greater amount. So that's the economic analysis that gives you a bit of a picture of the scale of the problem. What I'll do now is I'll go through according to those three pillars that I set out before, and I'll look at the individual action items and give you a bit of a flavour of what we're doing in each of those. So hybrid mismatch arrangements exploit the differences in tax treatment of an entity or an instrument under the laws of two or more tax jurisdictions to achieve double non-taxation. Now, often this is by being able to claim a deduction in one jurisdiction yet not have income taxed in the other jurisdiction. It might involve two deductions, no income, or two deductions and some income. There's a whole range of possible permutations, but the fundamental issue here is that what we're talking about is a mismatch between the tax laws in two or more countries and how that is leading to an outcome of double non-taxation. What we've delivered is a common approach that will facilitate convergence of national tax practices through principally domestic law changes, but also through some treaty rule changes, which will allow these arrangements to be neutralised. And the measures that are proposed take the form of recommendations for linking rules that align the tax treatment of an instrument or an entity with the tax treatment in the other jurisdiction. Importantly, we seek to do this in a way that doesn't disturb in any other way the commercial outcomes that might be occurring or being pursued. And we do this through the operation of a primary rule, but then also a defensive secondary rule is available. And as I said earlier, there will be some changes to the model tax convention to help with hybrid entities. Action three relates to CFCs, controlled foreign corporation rules, which are essentially designed to bring back the income received by a CFC that should be attributable to the domestic entity which is exerting control over the CFC. Now, in order to recognise the varying policy objectives among jurisdictions, this is not presented as a minimum standard. So in terms of the rules that we're bringing forward, we have minimum standards, which are things that we expect countries to all deliver. We have common approaches, which are largely about identifying the preferred approach that should be taken, but with a view towards countries moving to that over time. And then we also have best practices, which countries may or may not choose to adopt, but if they are going to undertake measures in that area, they are agreeing to take into account those best practices in doing so. So here, not a minimum standard, but a common approach or the presentation of best practices, but are designed to ensure that those jurisdictions that choose to implement CFC rules, that they have effective rules in place. And the recommendations provide guidance, the building blocks for effective CFC rules by focusing in on a number of dimensions that I set out there in the slide. Interest deductibility, action four. Now this is an important one and certainly attracted a lot of interest throughout the process. And there are significant BEPS risks connected with interest deductibility. And I mentioned earlier in the economic analysis that we found that BEPS distorts the question of the location of debt, and that we see concentrations of debt in high-tax countries. Using intragroup loans to generate interest deductions in excess of the group's actual third-party interest expense. And another phenomena that we have observed as well is that for some groups, their net external or third-party debt levels are at one particular level, but then when you look at all of the intra-group financing that occurs, that they can have much, much greater levels of debt in terms of related party debt. Now, in some cases, there might be arguments and reasons for that, but often when the difference between the two is so great, it does also point to the existence of tax planning activity. And also the use of interest debt to fund tax-exempt income is also a particular BEPS risk. So the common approach that has been put forward here aims at ensuring that an entity's net interest deductions are directly linked to the taxable income generated by those economic activities. So this is going back to that principle of trying to achieve a greater alignment between where profits are reported for tax purposes, where the economic activity that created those profits occurs. And we do that by fostering increased coordination of national rules through a fixed ratio rule. We also put forward the idea of a group ratio rule and some additional optional elements. Now, basically, the fixed ratio rule will allow net interest deductions up to a fixed net interest to EBITDA ratio. And that applies to interest paid to third parties and intragroup. And we've set out a corridor of between 10 and 30%. That will, it'll be important in terms of the local circumstances of individual countries. But we do provide factors that will help countries be able to determine where the appropriate space within that corridor might be for their country. We also offer up the possibility of a group ratio rule, which allows interest deductions up to the net interest EBITDA, that should be ratio of the group. So this is a way of saying, well, if for some reason that group, by virtue of the nature of what it does, is likely to have higher levels of interest expense perhaps than other industries or other sectors or other groups, there might be a justification for that. But one way of determining that is by looking at the worldwide ratio and comparing that to the ratio that an individual affiliate may have in place. There are also additional optional elements that have been considered. So you can have a de minimis threshold, which will allow for essentially carving out some activity, carry forward and carry back provisions, exclusion for third party interest funding of certain public benefit assets. And that's something that some countries identified as a particular area of interest. And there will be further work that will be undertaken in this area as well. Harmful tax practices is action five. And this has broadly involved two dimensions. And one of those dimensions has been about preferential regimes. And the other one is about transparency of tax rulings. When we talk about the preferential regimes, we've sought to achieve a minimum standard based on an agreed methodology to assess whether substantial activity exists within a preferential regime. So if a country has a preferential tax regime, in the past there's been a lot of activity that the OECD has done over a number of years to determine whether or not those practices are harmful tax practices. One of the key elements that we've often focused in on is whether or not there is a requirement for substantial economic activity in order to access the benefits of that regime. Now, the focus of our work here, to some extent, has been seen to be on the patent box, but the principles that have been expounded in that context are ones that we think are applicable to all preferential regimes. And in terms of improved transparency through mandatory spontaneous exchange on rulings, that is another area where we have seen some focus on rulings that individual countries may have entered into with particular taxpayers. In those areas that I've set out in the bullet points there, where rulings are entered into by a tax administration, there will need to be a spontaneous exchange of those rulings with other tax administrations where there is a connection with the arrangement or the transactions that are involved there. So that will be another important element of transparency. I should have mentioned too, with the IP IP regimes, the approach that we came up with is called the Nexus approach, and it will not outlaw the existence of patent boxes, but it will mean that if they are to be compliant, they will need to ensure that there is a strong substantial activity requirement in place. So there has to be a nexus between the expenditure, the R&D activity that has led to the patent and the place where the income is being reported and the benefit of the patent box being received. Action 6, which has focused on preventing treaty abuse, and in particular treaty shopping, is one of the, and has been one of the major sources of BEPS. There is a minimum standard proposed on preventing abuse, including through treaty shopping. And new flexible rules that provide a minimum level of protection against treaty abuse, including treaty shopping, have three elements. One is an express statement in the double tax agreements that the intention is not to create opportunities for non-taxation. But then also there is the provision of a specific anti-abuse rule in the form of limitation on benefits rule, and also the availability of a general anti-abuse rule, which is described as the principal purpose test. Now, there's some flexibility for countries in terms of which of those they may choose or a combination of those they may choose, but that is something that we think will be effective in tackling treaty abuse. Permanent establishment, concept very well known to those involved in international tax, maybe not so much if that's not your daily activity, but business profits of a foreign enterprise are generally taxable in a state only to the extent that the enterprise has a permanent establishment in the state to which the profits are attributable. So through this piece of work, we seek to address techniques used to inappropriately avoid that tax nexus. So to essentially allow the activity to occur to generate the profits, but to not have a permanent establishment and therefore not have to pay tax in that jurisdiction. We have focused here on those particular areas, such as where distributors have been replaced with commissionaire arrangements. We've also focused on those activities that are sought to take advantage of exceptions, in particular around the notion of mere preparatory or auxiliary activities, and also in relation to activities to fragment the activity of a corporate group. And also the splitting up of construction contracts is one area that we've focused in on. In terms of the definition of PE in tax treaties, where the activities that an intermediary exercises in a country are intended to result in the regular conclusion of contracts to be performed by a foreign enterprise, that enterprise should be considered to have a taxable presence in that country unless intermediary performing activities in the course of an independent business. Now, this will involve changes to the Model Tax Convention. Transfer pricing, I mentioned that there were 13 reports but 15 action items. We have the one report that deals with action items 8, 9 and 10. Transfer pricing rules are essentially the way in which we seek to determine the conditions, including the price, upon which transactions undertaken between entities within an M&E group are to be treated. And the work that we've done here ensures that transfer pricing rules secure outcomes that better align operational profits with the economic activities that generate them. So going back to that first slide that I focused in on, key principle of what we're seeking to do. Existing standards in this area have been clarified and strengthened. We provide more guidance on the arm's length principle, an approach to ensure the appropriate pricing of hard-to-value intangibles, guidance on transactions involving cross-border commodity transactions, and also guidance on low-value-adding intra-group services. Now, both of those last two bullet points are areas that were identified as critically important by developing countries as part of the engagement that we had with them. And guidance will be supplemented with further work to be done for the G20's Development Working Group. I go through here in a little bit more detail at what each of those action items has sought to address. Action 8 in intangibles, consider transfer pricing issues related to controlled transactions involving intangibles. Since intangibles are by definition more mobile and are often very hard to value. Misallocation of the profits generated by valuable intangibles has also heavily contributed to BEPS activity. Action 9 focuses in on risks and capital. Contractual allocations of risk are respected, only when they are supported by actual decision making and thus exercising control over these risks. So this is a case of making sure that the rules have an eye on not just the legal form, but also in practice, the operation of the arrangement, and to ensure that that is reflected in that way for tax purposes. Action 10, other high-risk transactions, including the scope for addressing profit allocations resulting from controlled transactions, which are not commercially rational, and we go through and the use of certain type of payments between members of MNE groups, management fees, head office expenses, and the use of those to erode the tax base in the absence of any alignment with value creation. Action 11, I mentioned earlier the economic analysis and the findings, but it's worth noting that there were four elements to that: assessment of available data, presentation of a dashboard of indicators, some of which I showed you earlier, to undertake an economic analysis, and that delivered the conclusion around the scale of tax losses, but also the economic effects, and then also the making of recommendations for new tools and data. And as part of those recommendations on that final bullet point, it has been recommended that the OECD work with governments to publish a new corporate tax statistics publication, which will include statistical analyses of country-by-country report data. So that's data that will be provided by countries in an anonymised and aggregated format, but for statistical purposes. And also that the OECD will work with governments to refine the indicators that we've created, but to also produce periodic reports on the estimated revenue impacts of proposed and enacted measures. And additional recommendations are made around the need for more research on MNEs in collaboration with academic researchers. And the conclusion is that only with better data and refined analyses will we improve the measurement and the monitoring of BEPS and the actions put in place to address it in the future. Action 11, mandatory disclosure rules. Tax authorities obviously face a lack of timely, comprehensive and relevant information on aggressive tax planning as a major barrier to their ability to police and to enforce the tax laws. This can be addressed by mandatory disclosure rules. They require disclosure often before returns are filed of certain transactions by promoters or taxpayers or both. Now, this is not a minimum standard, but the three key outputs for countries wishing to adopt mandatory disclosure rules are: we provide a framework for design of those rules that's flexible to country needs, special recommendations for rules that focus on international schemes, and also enhanced models of information sharing using the JITSIC network as a platform. Action 13, transfer pricing documentation. This is, I think, going to be one of the really significant outcomes of the package. So this involves improved and better coordinated transfer pricing documentation to increase the quality of information provided to administrations and to limit the compliance burden. It's a three-tiered approach, which includes a minimum standard on country-by-country reporting. But essentially, the three tiers are to have a master file, a local file, and then the country-by-country reports. And the country-by-country reports will involve, for large MNEs, a requirement to file an annual C-by-C report, providing each tax jurisdiction in which they do business with details of their revenue, profit, staff, assets, income tax paid, and other important details. These new requirements are to be implemented for the fiscal years beginning on or after the 1st of January 2016, and they apply subject to a review of this process in 2020. And it's limited to MNEs with annual consolidated group revenue equal to or exceeding 750 million euros, which is plus or minus around 9,000 groups, but accounts for a very, very large proportion of global activity. won't go into it in detail, but just to give you a snapshot of what this will involve is that companies will have to report on a jurisdiction by jurisdiction basis, and they will need to fill out details of, you know, the profit, income tax, the number of employees, and the assets. Now, this will provide rich information to tax administrations. At the moment, one of the challenges that tax administrations have is that they have information gathering powers, they have the ability to see what's happening within those entities within their jurisdiction, but often they have very little visibility of what's going on in related parties that might be across the border in another jurisdiction. Country by country reporting will give greater visibility to tax administrations, not for the purposes of raising tax liabilities, but the purposes of assessing risk. We do know that many companies are already undergoing, contemplating, and in some cases implementing reorganisation in order to ensure that structures that they may have had in the past, which will be seen to be structures that are quite aggressive when country-by-country reporting comes into play, are already starting to think about changes, reorganisation, and unwinding those arrangements. I set out here, I won't dwell upon it, but it gives you the timeline for the progress of the implementation of Action 13. Dispute resolution, which is an important action item, focused on improving dispute mechanisms, which we think is essential. It's always been essential, but it will be increasingly essential in the context of the implementation of the BEPS measures. We want to ensure that we avoid any unnecessary uncertainty for compliant taxpayers, and we want to avoid the prospect of double taxation. We have minimum standards to improve efficiency and effectiveness of the MAP, with agreement to have a peer-based monitoring mechanism, which is quite a significant change, and that will ensure that treaty obligations related to the MAP are fully implemented in good faith, and that MAP cases are resolved in a timely manner. That will also ensure the implementation of administrative processes that promote the prevention and timely resolution of treaty-related disputes, and to ensure that taxpayers can access the agreement procedure when eligible. Detailed terms of reference and assessment methodology will be developed in 2016. And significantly, in addition to this, there's been a commitment by 20 countries, and to put this in some context, they're involved in 90% of the outstanding MAP cases. Commitment from those countries to ban to mandatory binding arbitration in their bilateral tax treaties as a mechanism to guarantee treaty-related disputes will be resolved within a specified time frame. So more work to do in this area, but certainly considerable progress being made. As I say, in 2016, further work to be done. You see here, just to give you an idea of the problem, we have here the MAP cases that were initiated year by year, and then we also see here those that were completed. And you can see that there are a lot of unresolved cases, and that is something that countries have acknowledged needs to be addressed. So if I can go back now to those horizontal action items, action one, which is the challenges of the digital economy. Basic conclusion here is that it's impossible to ring fence the digital economy from the rest of the economy because the digitalisation of the economy is almost all pervasive. The digital economy does have some key features and does foster some business models that raise related but different issues. While there are no unique BEPS issues, the digital economy can, by its nature, exacerbate some of these BEPS concerns that have driven the project that we have been undertaking. We sought to address these by each of the other individual action items, the ones that I've taken you through. The report that we've presented also identifies some broader tax challenges. It considers and does some have a look at questions of nexus, data challenges. They're all analysed with potential options, including, you know, the potential for a notion of significant economic presence, a form of withholding tax, and equalisation levies. Remote digital supplies to exempt businesses and multiple location entities. This is the VAT challenges. I should just say that most of the focus of the BEPS project has been on direct tax, but of course indirect tax is an increasingly significant part of the share of tax revenues in most countries. And through the digital economy work, we had some focus on VAT. And to focus in on this, the first bullet point here on remote digital suppliers to exempt businesses and multiple location entities, that has been a very much a BEPS risk that we've targeted with the OECD guidelines on place of taxation for business-to-business suppliers of services and intangibles. Now, that part of the work was completed back in January of last year. But we've also focused on some broader challenges, such as collecting VAT on cross-border suppliers from non-resident suppliers, especially in the business-to-consumer trade, remote suppliers to consumers, and also low-value imports. Now, these issues have been issues of great significance that many countries have been very interested for us to do this work on. And in determining the place of taxation for business-to-consumer suppliers, so these are, you know, downloads that someone might be doing in one particular jurisdiction, you know, is VAT or GST applicable to that particular download is one example. Now, these are being addressed as part of the OECD VAT GST guidelines, and we're seeking to level the playing field between domestic and foreign suppliers. In the case of the download, if it's a domestic supplier, then it's a given that they will be registered for VAT or GST. But if it's a foreign offshore supplier, there may not be any interaction with the VAT system, and that obviously would provide an unfair competitive advantage to that supplier over the domestic supplier. The focus of the VAT is always on the destination principle, and that it should apply based on where the consumer lives. And we've also introduced simplified registration and compliance regime, which will be recommended to facilitate compliance. So one of the ways that you seek to get offshore foreign suppliers into the system is to streamline the compliance burden that they will face. There's also a focus on low-value imports. These are physical goods coming into countries. Many countries have low-value thresholds, so goods below a certain threshold, they don't subject them to the VAT regime. That is a particular issue with the emergence of more and more online trade. So someone is hopping on the internet, they're ordering a book or a bicycle or a camera from an offshore supplier. That comes in as a parcel. It's not subject to VAT or GST because it's below a threshold, whereas a domestic supplier of that good would be subject to VAT or GST. Action 15, the multilateral instrument. Really quickly, this is about recognising that many of the changes that need to be made will involve changes to tax treaties, to double tax agreements. There are more than 3,500 of these bilateral agreements that are in place. If we wait for countries to amend each of those agreements on a one-by-one basis, none of us will be around when that happens. So the intention is for this to happen much faster than that, and we've been exploring the idea of having a multilateral instrument, an international treaty, if you like, that will facilitate amendments to all of those agreements where parties are a signatory to that treaty to facilitate these changes in a much speedier fashion. Sometimes this is referred to as, you know, killing 3,500 birds with one stone. Quite a violent analogy, but the idea is that you will facilitate a much faster way of making those changes. process is underway. 90 jurisdictions are participating in that process. The first procedural meeting was in May, but an inaugural meeting will be held in November, and further consultation will be expected. Open for signature in 2016. So just to conclude, where to from here? Obviously, implementation is the key. We have developed standards. They will come into effect in different ways for different standards, some through transfer pricing guidelines, which will occur quite quickly. Some will require domestic law changes. Some will require changes to treaties. That will involve governments now making good on the commitments that they've made to implement these changes, to doing that in an expeditious fashion. Obviously, we'll be monitoring the implementation. That will be an important part of making sure that there is a level playing field. And monitoring may take different forms depending on the item concerned. And that's in large part because of the range of different commitments, whether it be minimum standards, common approaches, and best practices. And I have there a quote from the communique of the G20 finance ministers at their September meeting in Ankara, where they provided a further mandate. They said, "We will continue to work on an equal footing as we monitor the implementation of the BEPS project outcomes at the global level. And in particular, we call on the OECD to prepare a framework by early 2016 with the involvement of interested non-G20 countries and jurisdictions, particularly developing economies, on an equal footing." So this is about trying to build a more inclusive process for the future in terms of how we might monitor the implementation of the measures that we expect to take effect on a broadly global basis. Just finally, what are we already observing? Some people say to me, when do you expect these measures to start to have an impact? I think the truth is that some of them are already having an impact. We've seen some high profile cases. I won't mention countries, companies, we don't do that. But some companies in particular have already announced major reorganisation, restructuring, to go about doing their business in a slightly different way in order to make sure that they are not only consistent with the law as it stands today, but what we expect to be the norms as a result of the BEPS package. We see that in a recent survey from Thomson Reuters, Euromoney, that 180 tax professionals across 35 countries were surveyed, and more than 59% of them indicated that they're already implementing changes to their intercompany agreements. And this was released the day we released the package. So presumably the survey occurred before the package was released. More than 55% have said that they're planning to change the way they price intergroup transactions, and more than 66% are planning to review their business structures. Well, it is early days, but what that does show is that there is behavioural change already beginning to occur. And anecdotally, I was at a conference recently, and I mentioned before the country-by-country reports. One particular tax manager from a big M&E got up and said, "Well, we've gone through and we've basically tried to prepare a country-by-country report in advance so that we have a bit of an idea of what we're looking at." And there were actually some results there that struck us as a little bit odd and strange, and we're undertaking further investigation of that. So I think what you will find is that, yes, this will be an important tool for tax administrations in assessing risk, but it may also give a little bit of visibility to management in some respects about some of the arrangements that may be legacy issues that have built up through structuring over a period of time. And now certainly would be a very good time to address that as companies are looking to ensure that they are compliant with the expected new norms. So I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
You can stay just a little. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, David. We have time for one or two questions before we move on to our first discussant. Anyone? Yes, please. When you when you have a question, please use the microphone and also tell us who you are and where you're from.
Thank you. I'm Bertil Wiman from Uppsala University. And my question to you is on the on the more formal decisions on changes to the model, the commentaries, the guidelines. Yeah. As I understand, the council has decided on the reports, but the formal decisions will wait. And hints are that they may wait until you're more clear with the multilateral treaty. And it will be very useful for us and for practitioners to know your timeline with respect to those formal decisions.
Look, that's a good question, and you know, I think the starting premise should be that people should be operating on the basis that what has been announced in terms of those changes to the Model Tax Convention and the commentaries and the transfer pricing guidelines as well, that they will be implemented. They have been subject to formal approval by the OECD Council, and they've now been adopted by endorsed by the finance ministers. Obviously, the final tick of approval, if you like, in terms of the BEPS package and the BEPS process will be the G20 leaders. You know, we would fully expect that these recommendations will be endorsed at that level as well. And there was nothing in the finance ministers' meeting to suggest that that wouldn't be the case, but that is the next step in the process. And then, of course, in terms of formal OECD instruments, there is a separate process that is to be undertaken. Now, in terms of the formal timetable through which those instruments will be created, ratified in the usual way, that's not something that we have, you know, publicly set out a timetable for, other than to say that you should expect that those changes will be coming into effect as soon as possible. And I think in terms of activity, planning, advice, you know, people would be well advised to be making you know, their own judgments on what's appropriate, but we very clearly put out there what we anticipate to be the changes, and then it's a case of waiting for that formal implementation to occur. But I think of all the changes, they will be the ones that you will expect to come into effect much quicker, because they, in most cases, do not require domestic law changes. But, of course, you know, we do get people that have contacted us asking specific questions in the context of advice that they are wanting to give clients at that point in time, and we can't get into the business of that at all. But certainly, I think the expectation is that this will happen reasonably quickly, and I would be operating on the basis that those changes as forecast will be occurring.
Yes, I see several hands in the air, but we have just on time for one question now, and we'll come back later. So, please.
Good morning, Jérôme Monsonigo, Uppsala University. Thank you for your presentation. Congratulations on this impressive piece of work. A question relates to implementation. Obviously, the OECD will be working on making sure that countries do implement BEPS in their domestic laws and tax treaties. I'm wondering how the OECD will monitor the actual interpretation and application of the rules, because similar standards may be, of course, interpreted in different ways, tax treaties or transfer pricing, for example.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Look, that's a very good question, because it goes to the heart of implementation. There is the formal implementation, but how these measures are implemented from country to country may vary. In fact, some of the action items foresee the possibility that these particular practices, best practices and common approaches will be implemented in slightly different ways. Yeah, that is a process that we will have to work through. Obviously, the next step is to develop an inclusive framework, a proposition to take to the G20 finance ministers around monitoring and implementation. Then the next level of that will be drilling down into determining how that monitoring will occur, in a very practical way, how we will be monitoring changes that are implemented and the extent to which they might be consistent with the overall findings of the package. So that's something that is still work in progress and will continue to be a big part of what we do. But your question underlines the very fact that even though the package has been released, there is still a lot of work that will still need to be done in terms of implementation and monitoring, and that will be a very important part of what we need to do in the future. So it's a very good question, and it is work in progress.
Thank you. And now we welcome our first discussant, Yvonne Bertlin from AstraZeneca. Welcome.
Thank you very much for being invited as a speaker at this seminar and a very interesting topic. To start with, while reading the BEPS reports, and of course I haven't read all of them, but I'm impressed of how speedy it has been delivered. And also that BEPS are trying to solve a lot of matters from non-double taxation, but also to avoid double taxation. But as we all know, specifically when something is very speedy delivered, it might not be that easy to find also practical solutions to all of the objectives that are raised. From a taxpayer perspective, or I'm from AstraZeneca, as you know, so I am saying what we specifically appreciate is the actions that are put in place to mitigate against double taxation. So it's Action 14 regarding dispute resolutions to make them more effective, and also the multilateral instrument that we are looking forward that many countries will sign up to. I will continue to commenting on some of the actions that are relevant for ACET, and starting then with Action 4, interest deductions. As you heard from David, or it's the summary here, as we see them, they will be pretty flexible going forward. And in the reality, I don't know how many countries that are really changing the rules going forward, and we don't know at this stage. So from a company perspective, we need to watch specifically for us, it's what happens in UK, what happens in the US, as well as Sweden. And those rules, the recommended is a corridor based on EBITDA between 10 to 30%, so you could see quite low or quite generous. They should be supplemented with a group test for those countries that also want to allow an entity to deduct all third parties interest, as I understand. Could be also mitigated by way of carry forwards, carry backs, etc., and small companies should not be expect too many ways of not being able to deduct interest. I also find in the report a very interesting conclusions, as it said that a country may have interest limitations rules that carry out broader policy aims, and such as reducing the tax bias in favor of debt finance. And Actually, I was sitting in the Swedish Tax Commission for a couple of years, and this was heavily debated in the Tax Commission, and it was one of the objectives that we should solve ways of reducing the current debt bias or discrimination of equity-funded businesses. And the Commission were coming up with two proposals, and as I understand, since I had an opportunity to listen to Linda Hagren from the Ministry of Finance at a presentation last week, the plans is really that I will take forward the alternative proposal in Sweden with an EBIT rather than EBITDA limitation up to 20%. I furthermore understand that I will retain the current targeted rules in Sweden. That is quite tough for many companies. And maybe they are also on a long-term basis planning to move to the main proposal suggested by the Tax Commission. And from an AstraZeneca point of view, we are supportive of introducing something that are not discriminating equity. And in that proposal, it actually come with a restriction of interest, but also with a rate cut. And as you can understand, with huge intellectual property income, a rate cut would be important for ASAT in Sweden. Moving on to action five, that's the IP regimes. And this is, of course, also a very important action for ASAT. And according to BEPS, countries could still encourage R&D investments as long as they are not harmful. That's why they have designed a way of doing it, the so-called nexus approach. If we are looking at, and that is, as David was saying, we're mainly reviewed from a patent box regime perspective. So if we are looking at UK as an example, since we have a huge R&D facility in the UK, the old or the current patent box allows ASAT to only tax profits such as royalty or sales related to patent to 10% without any major substance requirements. We need to have or to prove an active management over our patents that are subject to the benefits. Going forward, the new UK patent box regime, we don't know the details because it's subject to consultation, but it will be in accordance with the nexus approach. And we should still be able to tax patent income with 10%, but it will be in relation to a proportion of the R&D activities carried on in UK going forward. And it will not be including IP acquisitions when we are acquiring patents or interesting products from other countries, and not either related party or outsourcing cost. And our concerns with the nexus approach is more from a tracking and tracing perspective. And I think that's specifically maybe for pharmaceuticals, since we have thousands of patents. And OECD's recommendation is actually that it should be traced to the on a granular level or the lowest level as possible. But it should also be perhaps a possibility to measure it based on the products. And I think that that is the only way of doing it. Anyway, even if it's measured on a product basis, it takes between 8 to 12 years of research work, R&D work, before a product could be launched. And then we might have additional 8 years with income that should be subject to the lower rate of 10%. But we need to prove it. We need to prove that the income actually is related to the R&D spend. So we need to track and trace R&D cost for, say, 20 years, because the Nexus approach should be on an accumulated basis as well. And so we have started to look into how should we do that. Do we need to employ more people? Do we need to invest in systems? And also, most of our investments in R&D are actually not reaching the markets. It might only be 10%. So then we will spend a lot of time in measuring patents cost, even if it's we will not see any profits in the future. Of course, we are very glad that it's retained, because it's still a material benefit to ASET. So we are prepared to doing that additional work just to retain to get that benefit. From a Swedish perspective, I know that many companies are saying, yes, we want to see a patent box. The question is, have they digged into the Nexus approach and what it would mean from in ways of practical challenges? From an ASET perspective, we would therefore rather prefer, in terms of incentives for R&D, to go for a more low-rate, broad-based concept, mainly since the patent box is under the new Nexus approach is far too complicated, and it might be hard to prove actually what our profits are in the future. Permanent establishments and action number 7. For ASET, this is not of a major concern, and but as I understand, it might be of major concern for other companies. And we were also very pleased that there was a clarification in the report saying that when a pharmaceutical company are having sales representatives in the country that are promoting our products to a doctor, that should not really create a permanent establishment, because the sales is actually from another distributor to the customer. So you don't have a direct link. So we are very glad for that. Of course, we need to do some homework and review. Do we have more permanent establishments? So we will start to do that soon and be fit and ready when BEPS's implemented. I also want to highlight that, because I understand that the profit attribution guidance is not totally finished yet, but the recommendation is really that it should be crystal clear in that guidance, because there's always, or I have seen that in many cases, a tendency that in a discussion involving competent authorities. You could describe it as a bit of a horse trade. The other country might start asking for something that they don't believe in, just to end at something more realistic at the end. To avoid lengthy discussions, also to save some time for the government perhaps, our recommendation is really to make this profit attribution guidance very clear. Also, to have a grandfathering period, because I know that companies will have to perhaps restructure to be ready for the new definition. Moving on to transfer pricing, and this is where ASET will probably be most impacted. But again, I think that the final report that are giving much more emphasis towards the risk element, we're very glad for that, as we are an IP-rich company. And regarding our recommendation, what we would see here is really in terms of implementation, as that will probably be the next challenge, and we want it to be implemented in a consistent and coherent way to avoid double taxation. Do you also foresee an increased numbers of inquiries in transfer pricing matters from tax authorities and disputes between governments? And if we take ASAT as an example, we do have operations in about 100 countries, and we are currently involved in about 20 audits, transfer pricing audits. And after BEPS, we foresee that this will increase, so we will need to spend more resources on transfer pricing, and we also need to spend more resources and actually seek help from the competent authorities helping us with APAs. So I will seek out to Ingela, or you're not working with that anymore. some more time and more of compliance and documentation burden in the future as well, because we probably need to dig much more deeper into our functional analysis. And also regarding hard to value intangibles, that is, as I understand, also still subject to some further guidance, but it's we see a huge risk there, because most of our intangibles in ASAT, I would say, is quite hard to value. It's the nature of it when you have a success rate of 10%. And if the tax authorities should then be able to challenge the price if we have sold something with a 10% success rate, if it's a successful product, they will, of course, say, yes, we want to have more. You probably know that it should be successful. But and in the opposite way, they will probably be silent if it's not successful. So clear guidance on hard to value intangibles is also what we would like to see. Finally, dispute resolutions. As BEPS, all the BEPS action is likely to lead to an increase of taxation and treaty-related disputes. It's extremely important that dispute resolutions mechanisms are improved, moving in line with the implementation of the other BEPS actions. It should be clear framework for mutual agreement procedures, best practice. And we are also, we would really encourage governments in all countries to put in place adequate resources, because we will need you. We will need help in negotiating the disputes, and in many countries they do have attendance and say you need to pay for being able to play, so you need to pay upfront. So in case of they are funding something that do not like, please pay the tax bill. And if a dispute takes several years to resolve, we actually need to pay the cash in advance, so that's a big disadvantage. And we also, in many times, need to provide for it in our accounts. So you could say we are already facing a double taxation situation, even if it's solved at the end. So what we think it's important is the action that I understand 20 countries has been signed into so far, to include mandatory binding MEP arbitration clauses, maybe in the multilateral instrument procedure. And we would really recommend more countries, or all countries, to sign into to that approach. Finally, that's my final conclusions, if I have time. I had a presentation in the Swedish Parliament in spring, and then I was very worried about the Swedish tax base, and also in relation to BEPS. I'm not that worried as I were in May, because I could see some improvements in that area. But still, with all these international movements, BEPS, An increased demand from the UN for more source taxation. A possible allocation of IP income related to the EU's CCCTB project, where IP income might be allocated in Europe based on sales. I could see a lot of risks still for the Swedish tech space. Also in terms of greater demand for profit splits. And we have already been approached by another large country that they want to have a profit split with Sweden, and we can't understand why, and it's not in line with OECD. So the profit splits recommendations or outline will also be very important. I think I need to stop there.
Yeah. Thank you, Yvonne. We have time for one question to Yvonne.
Crystal clear.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I actually have one question. It seems to me that AstraZeneca is quite well prepared for the outcome of the BEPS project. Do you think that is the same for most large multinationals, or will some companies face trouble when these new rules come into place?
Since the reports were just issued last week, I would say no one is really prepared, we don't know how it will be implemented in each country. It's like the interest for it's a lot of flexibility still, so I think everybody will need to review their structures, review the BEPS sections, and start the implementation phase.
Okay, thank you. Then we welcome our second discussant, Ingela Wilfors from the Ministry of Finance. Welcome.
These technical problems. Well, let me first thank SNS for arranging this seminar on a very important issue. The BEPS package is the most fundamental changes in international tax rules in almost a century. I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank David and his colleagues at the OECD. You've done a fantastic job. We are very impressed. Well, Sweden has supported the BEPS because, of course, counteracting BEPS is a high political priority. It is important to stress that BEPS package offers a coordinated approach for countries to counteract these problems. And because of the importance and also on the big impact the project will have for a country like Sweden, we have actively participated in this work. We have been involved in almost every working group. We have been into hundreds of meetings. We send in hundreds of thousands of comments, written comments into the project. About 15 people have been involved from the Minister of Finance in this project, and from the tax authorities, I think, more than that. So I'm quite proud to say that we actually belong to the countries that has invested the most resources into this project? So what has then been some of the major key points for Sweden in this project? Well, of course, there should be less opportunity for aggressive cross-border tax planning and double non-taxation, and we would like to see no more harmful tax practices. But at the same time, we have stressed throughout the whole project that it is important that the action take into account the legitimate interest of small, open economies that are dependent on exports, countries like Sweden, of course. And it's also important that the proposed solutions do not go beyond what is necessary to take care of identified problems with BEPS, that is, problems connected to double non-taxation. Well, what does that mean? It means that BEPS should not be about changing international tax principle if it has nothing to do with BEPS. Another important point for us has been that the aim with BEPS work should be to create clear rules to avoid disputes and to reduce the administrative burden. Well, that sounds good, but what does that mean in practice? Yeah, it can, for example, mean that we are prioritized to prolong the process rather than having unclear rules. We think it is good that there are remaining issues. There are still technical work to be done. I will talk more about that later. And I think David had mentioned some of the work, and also Yvonne. For instance, on the transfer pricing guidelines, there are remaining issues in around 6 different areas. For example, as Yvonne mentioned, how to value intangible, profit splits, financial transactions, etc. And we strongly supported the idea of postponing this important work to the post-BEPS work. But of course, you also have to be realistic. Regarding, for example, Action 6 to 10, the tax treaty-related issues, the transfer pricing guideline. 2 years is an extremely short period to elaborate new guidance. The transfer pricing report, for example, it contains 181 pages, and it's 181 pages of very complex rules. And they are not only complex, they are also the result of compromises, many compromises. And as a consequence, as I think also Yvonne mentioned, in some areas, the report is not as clear as we had wanted it to be, as it would have been if we had continued for 5 years, if less countries had been involved in this project. And for this reason, it has been very important for us to take the work on dispute resolution as far as possible. Action 14 on dispute resolution includes a minimum standard, and that is very important. And I think David explained what the minimum standard means. It means that you have to implement. There is no choice, you have to do it. So I think this question, or the question of whether BEPS is finished now, has already been answered. I hope you don't think it has, because it hasn't. It's an ongoing project, and there is a lot of important work to be done at the OECD, but also at the national level. It is only the first phase, the reports, that has been finished. First, technical work remains in many of the actions. I mentioned transfer pricing as one, but there are many other actions that where there was a lot of work to be done, and therefore also I understand Yvonne when she said that, well, can we move on? Can we implement it at the corporate level? Yeah, you can do that. You know the directions, but you know don't know all the details. Secondly, to be able to implement the changes in the tax treaties efficiently, as David said, you don't want to negotiate 3,600 treaties. a multilateral instrument is being developed. And there is an ad hoc group where about 90 countries are involved, but also a steering group, a bureau, where Sweden also will be participating. And this work should be finished in the, hopefully in the end of next year. And as I mentioned before, arbitration will be very important to ultimately solve double taxation. Today, 20 countries are willing to adopt binding arbitration. We think that is not enough. Why should countries like Denmark not be one of the group in the 20s? You shouldn't mention countries, but I really can't avoid doing that given this opportunity. So I think we have to work hard there to get more countries on board. Of course, as David mentioned, monitoring will be very important to ensure that measures are implemented, in particular the minimum standards. Peer reviews, better data to measure BEPS, all to create a level playing field. And finally, to get all countries worldwide on the boat, that is a key issue for the future. OECD has been working very hard to include developing countries. I'm really impressed with the work that the OECD has done here. But the work must continue. It's not the end. It's the inclusive framework is only the beginning. So that is crucial, that the new guidance can be accepted globally, and that it is the OECD that continues to set international accepted standards. So of course, it's not the OECD that has to do all the work. It's also for a lot of work at the national level. Implementation has to continue or to start. Country by country reporting, that's a minimum standard, and the work to implement that measure has already begun. Report on hybrid, that is not a minimum standard, but there is a strong recommendation to implement that action because it is linked to tax treatment in other jurisdictions. And interest deduction rules, well, they are not minimum standards either. And the recommendation is quite flexible, allowing for countries to use different approaches in their international tax legislation. And as you heard, we are about to change our current interest deduction rules. And of course, the OECD work here will influence our work as well. Our current CFC rules, well, they are actually in line with many of the proposals in the OECD recommendations on CFC. It is not a minimum standard, but there might be a need anyway to update our rules. Well, as you heard, the OECD has been calculating the economic effects of BEPS worldwide, and you can also see a figure there for Sweden. Well, a relevant question is, of course, what the economic impact of the BEPS project is for Sweden. I think that question is very difficult to answer, if not impossible, at this point, and that is not only because I'm a lawyer. Actually, BEPS is a package of measure in many different actions. I think it's likely that some actions, for example, action 5, harmful tax practices, 2, hybrid instruments or hybrids, 4, interest deduction rule, well, of course, they will have a positive economic effect for Sweden. But that will also depend on post-BEPS and on which of those actions that are not minimum standards that will be implemented into Swedish law. And it depends on the actions that M&Es will undertake. I expect there to be some restructuring at least. Actions on treaty abuse and permanent establishment could have a negative effect because there might be more foreign tax to credit against the Swedish tax. But I'm not sure David wants to hear this. But PE is not a minimum standard. That is, I would say, maybe the action where we are not really that happy with the OECD work. We think that it's really a bit too far-reaching. So that will be, that is, you know, in the future work of the multilateral instrument. So it will be decided whether countries will make a reservation or not. So it's, you must remember, it's really not the minimum standard. So that is important to say. And of course, I guess also multinationals and other companies will restructure here to avoid maybe those rules. In relation to transfer pricing, I would say it's not possible to foresee the economic effects. TP actions targeted at cash boxes, at patent boxes, well, they could have, of course, we hope that they will have a positive effect. But in some area, there is a risk that tax authorities in other countries will overinterpret the rules with a negative effect to the Swedish tax base as a result. I think that is what also you, Yvonne, envisaged. And I would say that there, since we had so little time to elaborate these guidelines, of course there will be difficulties with interpretation and maybe over-interpretation by some jurisdictions. So effect on BEPS will also, of course, depend on post-BEPS. Which measures will be implemented? What will be the result of the remaining work on transfer pricing guidelines and the tax treaties? And last but not least, what will the UN do? Will the BEPS package have an impact on Swedish enterprises with cross-border activities? Yes. I think that most companies with cross-border transactions will be affected, since BEPS contains fundamental changes to international tax rules. Since we talk a lot about M&Es, but if you have cross-border transaction, even smaller companies will be affected I think, in many ways. And I think it will be very important, even to on high levels in companies, to be well informed about these measures and to follow the post-BEPS work, to review the impact of the measures and to consider whether restructuring is necessary. Well, are we pleased with the result of the BEPS project so far? Yes, I think we are. We have been able to influence this work a lot. And the result is a comprehensive, coherent, and coordinated reform of the international tax rules. It gives us new instruments to tackle BEPS, and also it also creates a level playing field, which is very important. And it should not be forgotten that it also, as David mentioned, a response to unilateral measures that countries had started to undertake. And I would also like to emphasize the importance of having OECD in the driver's seat instead of UN or other international organizations. Finally, I would once again like to stress, if you haven't understand that, that the post-BEPS is very important. It's like a triathlon. You have fought very hard, you have swimmed, you are so exhausted, you're tired, you think that you have reached the finish line, but you have not. You've just done the first phase. You can hardly breathe. You see the bike in front of you, and you know you have to to get up from the water, to jump on the bike, and to do something else, to do the second phase, the post-BEPS work. So that is where we are. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Ingela. We have time for one question to Ingela before we have a panel discussion. Yes. We just wait for the microphone here.
Thank you. I am Rune Andersson. I have a lot of small and middle-sized companies. I have one question concerning transfer pricing, because I think that has created historically a lot of work for us already, and now we are finally through it. This threshold of 750 million euro, I guess, is a group threshold. But in all companies, even far bigger than that, you can find hundreds of small entities which are completely independent from each other. Mm. And how do you look at that big job I can foresee for transfer pricing? Shouldn't it be better to have a threshold for each entity? Because then they have all the resources, administrative resources. But a lot of small companies, it will be an enormous pain to do this job.
Yeah, actually, I think that transparency documentation will be crucial. So to say that the administrative burden for companies and for tax authorities will increase, that is, and I think in transfer pricing field you need to have documentation anyway, because when people complain about, well, we have to document our transfer pricing, I wonder, well, how else can you do transfer pricing? Are you guessing or what? So I think that it depends on how you have followed the guidelines already. So I think that for many countries, you should have a lot of documentation already in place. When you talk about the threshold, well, that was a compromise solution which were lively debated. We were looking into a lot of different measures, of course, but that was something that was, that was, as David mentioned, a very, very important issue for action for developing countries, especially. So that was, more or less something that we were very happy that we could have this threshold as such. But there will be a review. So I will say that I didn't say that, but the triathlon will continue until 2020 at least. So at that point, there will be also a review on the action 13, I think, because that is, I think it should not be the most important issue for companies, but I think many will think that it is, because that it is first things that will hit them very soon. So therefore, I think it's you have to prepare for it, especially for a country like Sweden having so many head offices, because it's the head offices that will have to collect all the information and to distribute it. Or distribute it to tax authorities that we do, but of course.
Yes. I think we will have the panel now, and we have a quarter of an hour left, and I think we will have very short questions, very short answers. We'll get many questions, because I'm sure that with such a highly competent audience, I'm sure we will get very many and very good questions. First, just would like David, do you have a short response to the comments? Anything in particular you want to mention?
Look, I think just on that question of country by country reporting and the threshold, I think that has been a contentious issue throughout. And this is a good example of how the process has had to operate, being one of consensus. We've needed to get all of the countries together and to agree on a minimum standard in this case. And one of the big criticisms, if you read the news coverage of the package, one of the biggest criticisms has actually been from the non-government organisations about country-by-country reporting. And the two elements of the criticisms there have been, firstly, that documentation is not going to be made publicly available. And the second one is criticism about the threshold, saying that means that too many multinationals operating below that threshold will not have to report for the purposes of country-by-country reporting. So I think what I can say is the fact that there is a threshold is an acknowledgement of the importance of trying to strike a balance between additional compliance requirements and recognising that we need to do something in this area. So very difficult question. Look, in the end, wherever you set that threshold, there are always going to be some groups that fall below that and some that fall just above that. One issue that does arise is if you do make it apply on an affiliate by affiliate basis, as with any set of rules that apply on that basis, you create an incentive for people to structure their affairs in a way that keeps them below that threshold. Mm-hmm. So that's the problem with that approach as well.
Thank you. Now we have a short question from Sven-Olof. We'll only have short questions today. And short answers as well.
Sven-Olof Lodin, it's me. Concerning additional optional elements, it seems in this final report, it seems to be some room for different national solutions as long as these solutions is in line with the main purpose of the BEPS project. But not all of them, they're not mentioned. Well, one is mentioned, that's EBIT instead of EBITDA. And I think Sweden will use EBIT because of our very liberal depreciation rule, which makes up for the DA, so to say. The other one question is the restriction of the deductibility of negative net interest. You say there could be other goals than only the fighting of BEPS. So as I understand when I read it, but it's not clearly said, that the Swedish proposal of promoting equity the proposal of the tax committee of not giving any deduction for negative net interest and combined with a lower tax rate is within the framework of possible. It's possible within the framework of EBIT.
Do you want to answer the question about the Swedish approach, and I can talk more generally about the interaction.
Well, I'm not been into the commission, so I'm sure that Ivan and Sven-Olof are more into the details. But as I've understood it, generally speaking, there is enough flexibility in this action to allow for Sweden to take the approach that we would prefer to take. So that's not a direct answer to your detailed question, but.
Thank you. And I think Yvonne,
you may know more about that.
I may know, of course, I can't. It's up to the government to decide, of course, but I think Action 4 is enough flexible to allow for that model, since it says that the policy could be designed also to solve the tax bias issues. And also it says that it could be stricter rules than the EBITDA 10 to 30% plus special rules. So that's my understanding.
And David?
Look, that certainly the approach on action item 4 has been to allow flexibility. So that is all of what has been said is consistent with the flexibility that is envisaged. There is also this question, And to some extent, we often, from a policy perspective, like to segregate the two issues, one of debt bias and the other one of debt shifting, if you like. And to some extent, the focus of Action 4 has been on the debt shifting question. But that's not to say that countries may not seek to use the rules that they put in place to address debt shifting to also address the question of debt bias. And in fact, certainly the strong position taken throughout by Germany, as an example, is that they do believe that the rules that they have in place have always been focused on both of those objectives, to tackle both the question of debt shifting and also the question of debt bias. But of course, from a BEPS perspective, the focus of our activity here has really been on that question of debt shifting rather than the debt bias, which we see as being a much more general tax policy question that's not about aggressive tax planning, but is about judgments that you form about the extent to which you might want greater neutrality in the treatment of debt and equity in from a tax policy perspective.
Thank you. And now, next question. We have one question here. Let's wait for the microphone.
Hi, I'm Annika Lindström from KPMG, and I, of course, have a question for Ingela. What is the implementation plan from a Swedish perspective?
Well, I thought I talked this about that. Do you mean
the timeline when we can expect changes in law and things like that?
Well, so, as I said, much of the work is still to be done. So when it comes to minimum standard, of course, we have started with the country-by-country reporting. So that will be the first action that will be implemented. When it comes to transfer pricing, as you're well aware of, that will be more or less directly implemented, so we don't have to do anything on a national level, hopefully. When it comes to the other, like CFC rules, we don't know if we are going to do something there. Hybrids probably will do something. But it's really too early to answer that question. I think they will, already the country by country reporting is actually a big challenge. I think not only for the tax administrations and for the companies, but also for the legislators. So it's a new piece of work.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. More questions? One question here in the back. Here comes the microphone.
Thank you. Well, Ingela, you touched upon, I think, an interesting question when it comes to transfer pricing. May the new guidelines be implemented directly, or will they have some retroactive effect? When it comes to tax treaties, of course, when there's like substantial change, it's special to articles. It applies only for the future. The guidelines have been changed. I think you may wonder, to what extent they may be applied retroactively. For example, if we have like substantial changes, or is there more? Is it mostly a clarification, and then could it be applied retroactively?
Yeah, I think it's a very good question and difficult to answer, because there's a big difference between other. If you change the PE rules, you change the articles themselves. You don't change the Article 9; it's still there. You change the interpretation of one article in 181 pages. So I think it will largely depend on also how, for example, the courts will interpret these rules. I mean, the retroactiveness of it is of course an interesting point, but as we see it and as it has worked so far, when there are new guidelines being implemented into the transfer pricing guideline, that will also have the effect both at the national level in relation to our own transfer pricing rule, but also, of course, it will be a part of how we will interpret Article 9 at the MAP discussions, in the APA discussions, and hopefully in arbitration.
Okay, thank you. And maybe two questions more. Yes, we have one here, and then we have last question from Sven-Olof.
Reijo-Salo Fortum. I'd like to raise a question to David about the different policies. Now, in this new setup, tax authorities have different ways to source information on international level, and of course also by country reporting. And of course, the information is used nationally. Now, there are a lot of risks for companies, for example, confidentiality and that sort of things. How is OECD going to develop policies concerning the rules for tax authorities in this area?
And maybe we take the second question immediately.
Yes, it has to do with the patent boxes. Dave and I and some people here, we attended all the IFA Congress in Basel, about 2,000 people there, taking part in the discussion on the BEPS, including the patent box, and also a special seminar on patent box. And this was a rather lively discussion, and I will only mention one thing, and that was the former head of taxation of OECD, Jeffrey Owens, which in very, we'll say, sharp words condemned the whole idea to introduce the patent boxes in the BEPS project, because they are so complicated, they don't really give any result in the amount of research, but it will be a new way of profit shifting, and they were trying to give the place the patents in the country with the most generous patent boxes. And also the seminar showed very well how very complicated this will be and how many dangers there are in doing the wrong choice. So you get stuck with things which doesn't fit in your real structure.
Thank you. So maybe you check Yvonne, David and Ingela just short answers to these questions if you have one.
Yeah, as explained regarding the patent box, yes, we are pleased to retain it in UK, but it's not the preferred option in Sweden, since it's far too complicated. So I could agree to those conclusions. But still, since UK are retaining its slimmed Nexus approach patent box, it's a competitive advantage to them. They are also reducing their tax rate to 18% from 2020. So they looks pretty attractive in terms of where we could invest.
Thank you.
Hard to give short answers to both of those questions, but just briefly, in terms of the protection of confidential material, the filing process would be to file in the parent's jurisdiction, and then the country-by-country report would be subject to information exchange through the usual channels between countries, between tax administrations. So this is not something that is a new process. Administrations have been exchanging information for many years on a confidential basis. The robustness of those procedures would be expected to continue in that way. In terms of the patent box, to be very clear, the OECD, through this process, is not expressing its support for the patent box as a policy tool. It is one approach that governments sometimes will embark upon to attract investment in a particular sector of the economy or particular sectors of the economy. But if you look at the economic research, and most of it has been focused on what we call input tax incentives, they're the ones at the front end of the process, whereas a patent box is an output tax incentive, which is where the income is taxed at a preferred rate, preferential rate, as opposed to concessions for expenditure, etc. The research thus far would demonstrate that the benefits of input tax incentives are generally greater to a country than the benefits that are provided by output tax incentives. Although we should qualify that by saying many of the patent boxes that have been in place have not had substantial activity requirements, so it's not surprising to see that that would be the case. What some research that has been undertaken also shows, and this is an emerging area because these things haven't been around for a long time, it shows that where there are substantial activity requirements in those patent box regimes, that you are more likely to get more of a economic outcome for the jurisdiction offering that benefit than you would if you didn't have the substantial activity requirements. So, look, individual countries acting as sovereign on tax matters will make their own decisions about how they might want to present incentives to attract investment. They are sovereign matters, as long as they're not undertaken in a way that erodes the base of others. And that's why we are, as my colleague Akim Prost likes to say, we're putting a box around the box. So the patent box is there, and we're putting a box around what you can do if you want to implement it.
A complicated box.
And Ingela, do you have anything to add on this?
Just to say something about this, the patent boxes, I guess it's not a secret that we would have preferred to go further than the final solution was. We have accepted it, but of course monitoring is very important, since we are a country having a lot of intangibles being developed, and we have a lot of R&D activities are very important. Of course we want them to be in Sweden instead of in the UK, and it shouldn't be about tax competition in the wrong way, so to speak. So we will hope that the OECD will monitor it, because when we were sitting at the OECD, it was very provocative to hear that Italy has introduced new rules, a patent box, and you know that there are more and more countries doing that. So I think it's very important that the OECD monitor and follow if the patent box works as it should. And also to add something, it's not about that's only, you know, the harmful tax practices of it. You must remember that if you're going to look at this from a company perspective, you must also remember that there are a lot of new transfer pricing guidance in this area that hopefully will neutralize some of the negative effects.
Thank you. Well, we are approaching the end of this seminar, and the BEPS project, it's a very big project, a very complicated project. I hope you have gained some more insights into it. And it is also my pleasure to announce the next big tax project that will have maybe such large impact that as BEPS, we don't know, but SNS is preparing to begin a national tax policy project on the Swedish tax system. So now, after all these reforms in international tax policy, we think that we will embark on reforming or propose reforms in the Swedish tax systems. And if your organization or company are interested in being part of such a project already from the beginning, please feel free to contact me. And if you are a researcher wanting to contribute to the project, please also feel free to contact me. And I am Rickard Eriksson, research director at SNS. And finally, let us give the all our speakers a very big hand.